next on AM 1480 WLEA, the Newsmaker Show. Here's Ryan O'Neill.
So much going on at the state capitol in Albany. So glad that we have Assemblyman Phil Palmesano on to discuss it. Assemblyman, thank you for joining us.
Hey, Brian, it's good to be with you again.
Well, Assemblyman Palmesano, where do we start? You sent out a statement yesterday on the abortion and legislation that was just signed the other night. And for months now, you have been saying that the Democrats are calling it legalizing Roe v. Wade or codifying Roe v. Wade for New York State. But you've been calling it abortion expansion, and properly so, because that's what it is. Give us your thoughts.
That's exactly what it is, Brian. It's an abortion expansion. It's not a codification only. Let's start first. Basically, what this legislation does is it allows for a late-term abortion, even up until the moment of birth. It takes away the fact that now with abortions would have to be provided by a doctor. So now you can have a non-doctor. It could be a physician assistant or a nurse practitioner, or even possibly a midwife might be able to perform an abortion because they fall within the health law. I think probably one of the other most appalling parts of this is that if, say, for example, and there have been stories of this. There was a press conference in Albany, I know the Senate Republicans did, and there's stories of this in the news all the time where an individual will assault a pregnant woman with the sole intention to terminate the pregnancy, to kill the baby. And now, under these changes of law, you know, taking out certain criminal description, now anyone who assaulted a pregnant woman and killed their unborn baby could not be brought up on any criminal charges relative to the murder of that baby. And I think that's pretty shockingly, but that just shows where, you know, some of the individuals who are supporting this legislation felt that it wasn't necessary. I just think it's wrong. And, you know, I think probably, Brian, one of the most appalling things to this whole part, after they passed the bill, they took a break, had a little party, went over to the governor's mansion, or was someplace so they could have a little celebration. The governor signed it. And regardless of whether you are support Roe v. Wade or opposed to it, the one thing, even though supporters of Roe v. Wade have to acknowledge, that every abortion stops a heartbeat. And that's not something they should be having a party or celebrating. I mean, that's something that's kind of sad, and to celebrate it like that is just kind of insulting and disappointing and, quite frankly, to me, disgusting.
Assemblyman, if I could stop you there, I wanted to ask you about this legislation. What they did was put a line through the line. They struck a line through the sentence that described assaulting a pregnant woman as a homicide. And I was talking to one pro-life activist who seemed to be under the impression the reason that they're doing this is so that abortion doctors can put an end to the baby's life if the abortion doesn't go through and the baby survives. And an accidental consequence of this is that in domestic dispute-type situations, you know, you have the situation of a boyfriend, friend of brother, whatever, father, whoever. Someone punches the pregnant woman in the stomach, and that'll be considered an assault, but not a homicide. What are your thoughts on what I just told you?
Well, I just think that striking that language, they wanted to strike, the proponents of the legislation want to strike it because they didn't want to take it out of the criminal process, which I think, listen, the fact of the matter is, this now will eliminate the ability for someone to bring up criminal charges of murder against someone who assaults and kills a pregnant lady's baby. And there's the charges right now, I think, pending up, I want to say up in Saratoga County, that the DA brought up charges in that case under murder. And, you know, some of my colleagues criticized, well, we thought that was the wrong thing. Well, the DA believes they can prosecute that and successfully prosecute it. But now, in the future, a DA would not be able to bring up charges of murder against an individual like that who physically assaults with the sole intention to kill an unborn baby. And I know we're going to have our debates about the abortion issue, but certainly in this specific instance, to basically remove that part of it from the statute, I think was shocking and shouldn't have been accepted, and it's just unfortunate. And I just think that's just very disappointing and very heartbreaking for me, this legislation that passed. So I don't get it. It's just wrong. And again, it's not a codification. For anyone who says it's a codification, I'm sorry that you're incorrect. This is a blatant, outright expansion of abortion that would allow a late-term abortion up until the moment of birth. And to take away that criminal aspect of someone who physically assaults a pregnant lady with a sole purpose to kill that baby, unborn baby, should be prosecuted for murder. That's just wrong. And again, these other expansions, allowing the non-doctors to perform abortions.
Somebody said to me they're just doing that to make it cheaper for the abortion providers because doctors are more expensive to pay than nurses are.
Well, and there's other parts of this. I mean, if you have different perspective, like right now under the law before this was signed, if you were going to have an abortion after 12 weeks, you would have to have it in a hospital setting. So that now that doesn't mean you can go into a clinic. And now that certainly poses a risk to the woman, for sure, if there are complications. They're not in a surgical facility. What are they going to do? That can pose a health risk for certainly to the woman. The other one is after 20 weeks, you're supposed to have two doctors in there for the thing, because if something were to happen and the baby came out viable, there'd be a doctor for the baby and a doctor for the mother. So that certainly poses a serious health risk for the mother, for the woman, and for the unborn baby. And I just think I just find this legislation very disheartening, Brian, quite frankly.
Talking with Assemblyman Phil Palmesano. Next up on our list of topics, the Dreamers Act. Free college tuition for illegals or undocumented immigrants. What do you make of that?
Well, this is another thing. I know the Dream Act, something they've been, you know, the advocates and some of my colleagues in the legislature have been pushing for, which would allow undocumented individuals or illegal individuals who are here illegally be able to get the tuition assistance program. And now with this free college tuition, be able to qualify for free college tuition if they meet the threshold. And I think for me, Brian, and for some of my colleagues, we just think this is quite frankly unfair from the perspective of we have families in our district right now that are struggling, you know, with the tax burden they have, with the then also trying to send kids to college. It's not very easy to do in this economy with the way things are. So kids taking out mountain loads of college debt to go to college. So why not expand access for these individuals to be able to go to college? But yet this is going to make it more difficult, and I think that's just the wrong priority. And I don't think this is the end of it, Brian. I think the next thing you're going to see is they're going to want a driver's license for illegal immigrants. And I just think this is the wrong approach. But this is what we knew was coming. You know, I told you, whether it's the abortion issue, whether it's the so-called voting reforms that we passed last week, this is what we knew was coming with a Democratic takeover of the state government, now the state Senate, which is usually a backstop to stop some of these liberal, progressive, out-of-touch measures. That's what's happening now, and elections have consequences. We're going to see more of it. I'm sure we're going to see more gun control-type legislation, gun restriction-type legislation. That's coming, I'm sure, at some point. That's what we expected to see. That's what we tried to tell people, why this election was so important, and now we got what people put in there, and that's unfortunate, and now we're going to have to deal with it. We're going to have to keep fighting and pushing back, but the numbers are challenging. But we'll continue to be outspoken and critical, and I'll continue to do that, continue to fight for this region, along with Tom O'Mara and Marjorie Burns, who our new assemblywoman from the who represents Hornell and the western part of Steuben County and Livingston County, and up into Monroe County, Joe Giglio. We'll continue to work together for this area, and we'll continue to speak out. But this is a challenge we have in front of us, and things are different in New York, and it's kind of concerning.
You know, that argument that was made, that's been made for years, that the New York State Republican lawmakers are no different than the state Democrat lawmakers in New York City, that the Republicans will always cave and do what the New York City Democrats want them to do. That argument went out the window when the Republicans lost the state Senate. It's a nice talking point, and I think it's something that announcers do because they want to seem like they're being fair to both sides, so they think that's a way to criticize the Republicans. It's kind of a generic criticism that's been made for years that the state Senate GOP and people like Senator Young are no different than the New York City Democrats, but that argument went out the window.
Listen, that argument is a totally fallacy argument. I know there's been legislation that was passed. There's, you know, the Senate majority who had a very small majority, 32-31. They had to govern, and compromise is part of this issue. I disagree with some of the compromises that were made, but the fact of the matter is, some of the things, if you go back to the SAFE Act, some of the things that were on the table didn't happen because of the Senate Republicans. You know, possible confiscation gun laws, things like that. I mean, that's what we're facing. These bills that have passed have been stalled by the Senate. Were stalled by the Senate Republican Conference because they had that slim majority of 32-31. That has now changed. It's not just in the majority that the Democrats have in the Senate. It's not just a slim majority of 32-31 or 33-30. It's an exceeding number of 40-23, and it's sad. That's makes it much more difficult for our members for the policies we want to get in place. And now it's up to us to continue to be outspoken, and we will. I know Senator O'Meara, Senator Young, all of us in the Assembly will continue to be outspoken and advocate for our areas and our region. I'll give you a perfect example. The governor's proposed cuts to this AIM funding is aid in incentives to municipalities. It was like a form of revenue share money. This is money that goes right to the local municipality, like the village of North Hornell, or the town of Hornellsville. The city of Hornell gets the money, too. Now, the governor proposed no cuts to the cities at all, so that's good for Hornell. But for the village of North Hornell, for the town of Hornellsville, for the village of Dansville, for all the towns in Allegheny County.
It's easier to say what towns will be getting funding. It'll be Canisteo, Addison, and Bath, and Steuben County, and Allegheny County, only one town, and that's Bolivar.
Yeah.
You look at Alfred, and it says zero.
This is Brian. This is absolutely ridiculous. In my opinion, this is another policy that's basically of the governor's. That's an outright assault on our local municipalities and our local property taxpayers. You know, that money is critical for these municipalities. He's saying it's not essential because it was like under 2% of their total budget. That's ridiculous. Who is he to say from Albany what's critical or what's not critical? That money is used for municipalities, for local roads and bridges and culverts. It's used to help pay for critical staff and services that the municipality provides to the residents and property taxpayers of that municipality. And so I'm hopeful that even the Senate majority will work with us and the Assembly majority will work with us, because I know other areas where there are Democrats in those areas had their villages and towns hurt, even Long Island, other parts of the state. It's significant cuts, so we need to restore those funding cuts. In fact, we should actually be increasing AIM funding to give more unrestricted aid to those municipalities so they can control property taxes, because what this will lead is going to lead to more property tax increases. The governor wants a tax cap in there. He wants to make the tax cap permanent, and I support making the tax cap permanent. What he hasn't done is hasn't been the partner in providing the assistance to the local municipalities the way they have. So now he's proposing to cut this important critical AIM funding. He's also cutting funding for municipalities for the local roads and bridges. He chips his flat, but he's cut the extreme winter recovery money that we had in there, $65 million, that we had to put back in there last year when he didn't propose putting it in there. That's money that goes right to the municipality to fix their local roads and bridges. These types of proposals are basically an outright assault on local municipalities and local property taxpayers. And these are some of the issues we're going to be fighting for and pushing for during this budget process, making sure our colleagues are aware of it, talking to them and educating them and saying we need to address this issue.
Going to take a quick break, and then we'll be back with Corning Republican Assemblyman Phil Palmesano.
This is a special announcement for all Americans who owe back taxes to the IRS or state. Pay attention. There's a special toll-free hotline set up especially for you. This hotline will give you free information on how you can legally reduce or eliminate your tax debt. Call the taxpayer hotline today at 800-459-1725. Grab a pen or put the number in your cell phone, 800-459-1725. You'll speak with qualified professionals who tell you how to stop the collection calls, IRS letters, bank levies, and wage garnishments, and they'll deal directly with the IRS on your behalf so you don't have to. Even if you haven't filed returns or you are already in a payment plan, you can still get relief. New IRS settlement policies have opened the doors for a fresh start. But hurry, this won't last forever, and your tax problem will only get worse if you do nothing or try to handle it yourself. It makes a big difference in who you call. So call the taxpayer hotline today for free information. 800-459-1725. 800-459-1725.
Checking in with meteorologist Rob Carolyn, who says it's going to get cold and then it's going to get icy.
It is, Brian. It's already down to 32 degrees in Buffalo, and they've changed over to snow, and that means we need to worry here in the Southern Tier about road conditions later today as it gets colder. Well, that means the snow that's falling later today is going to have the tendency to stick. The roads that are wet, they're going to have the tendency to get icy. So be very, very careful as we make that transition from temperatures above freezing to near freezing and then below freezing later this afternoon. Brian, the sun came up this morning at 7:30. It'll set tonight at 5:14. Cloudy and breezy with any rain showers changing the snow showers. Accumulations under an inch. 35 to 40 is the high. That's occurring right now. Temperatures will go down much of the day. Cloudy tonight, maybe a flurry or a snow shower. Colder overnight near 20. Tomorrow we're into some much colder weather. It'll be cloudy and breezy with scattered snow showers, 20 to 25. A few flurries and snow showers Friday night, 5 to 10 above. Scattered snow showers during the day Saturday, cold 15 to 20. Some periods of light snow during the day Sunday. Brian, the most amazing thing about right now, we're sitting between 35 and 40. It's currently 55 to 60 in Poughkeepsie, New York.
Rob, you say it's going to get colder, but it's not going to get to those Harper-type temperatures of 5 below, is it?
No, it doesn't look like we get that cold over this stretch, Brian. That cold that we had Monday, and it looks like that's going to hold off for a little while. We should be safe from those type of temperatures through the weekend.
Thank you, Rob. Back with Assemblyman Phil Palmesano. Assemblyman, something going on with decoupling the state standardized tests from the teacher evaluations. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, we passed legislation yesterday, and I know a lot of my comments have been critical, but I think this is good legislation. This is something I've been pushing for. A number of my colleagues on both sides of the aisle have been pushing for. We know about the Common Core implementation and all these heavy reliance on these statewide standardized tests being used. It's not a good thing. It's been used in the evaluation of teachers. We decouple that from the state perspective. It can, you know, the locals have the opportunity to negotiate that with the unions through collective bargaining if they wanted to use that, but that would have to be an agreement with the locals. But the state took that mandate off, so decoupling that use of these high-stakes standardized tests and evaluating teachers, we wanted to put more control back into locals' hands and dealing with these teacher evaluations, and hopefully this will help ease that burden and take some of that pressure, because a lot of teachers were teaching to the test and put a lot of stress on students and this process, and quite frankly, these standardized tests, in my opinion, don't do anything to measure the progress of a student, because nothing was ever used from these standardized tests to help gear instruction. It was just basically used as an assessment to say the student was this, a 1, 2, 3, or a 4, and what the teacher was getting assessed on. So I was glad we passed that, and hopefully the governor signs that so we can move forward and try to put back into measure evaluation measures that have more local control and input on how that works rather than the state dictating from above how this should be.
Assemblyman Phil Palmesano, the other issue is environmental conservation and energy policy was just discussed at the budget hearing. I'm skipping doing the budget hearings this year as Senator Flanagan took Senator Young off that committee. It won't be as interesting locally not having more of a local presence there. But you spoke. I didn't know that was coming up. But tell us about that.
Well, I was there because I'm now on. I was appointed by my leader to be on the Assembly Ways and Means Committee. Senator Young was the finance chair. They have the chairs have to sit there through all the meetings from start to finish, and usually the ranker as well. So yes, I was at that meeting, and in particular, questioned the Public Service Commission chairman and the president of NYSERDA relative to the governor's proposal on the Green New Deal. Continuing to increase the amount of generation that needs to be done by renewable type clean energy sources, and the other part of it, it was their goal now is to get 100% carbon free by 2040. I believe that's what they're looking for. Brian, in my opinion, I said this publicly at that meeting. This plan to be 100% carbon free by 2040 is completely unrealistic, completely unattainable. And the point I wanted to make to them is New York, by doing this, would devastate our economy, we would devastate our manufacturing industry, we would devastate our family farms, we'd devastate the trucking industry. The fact of the matter is, Brian, and I've said this to them and pointed it out, when you look at the amount of CO2 emissions that New York contributes nationally, as far as all 50 states and their territories, it's 3.3% of the total CO2 emissions for this country. But as a percentage of the total CO2 emissions globally, it's 0.5%. So what you're doing, all this impact might be feel good. It's not going to have a significant impact, because what happens with some of these things, Brian, because like I said, we'll lose our manufacturing. Businesses are going to go and generate where they can go into a state that doesn't have such a high costly regulation. And, you know, taxes, we pay some of the highest energy costs in the entire country. I think it was second or third, or maybe even the highest, but we're up there. So you're going to have businesses leading. They call this carbon leakage, where a business's generating capacity will go, this electricity, the load will be taken to another state. So then you're going to have more CO2 emissions in other states with not as strict and stringent regulations. So you're still going to have the CO2 emissions, but at the same time, they're going to take our CO2 emissions, but at the same time, they're going to take our businesses, our manufacturers, our trucking industry. What are we going to have, someone at the state line not letting trucks come through because of the CO2 emissions? I mean, this will devastate New York State's economy. We can't do this all on our own. I kind of relate it to the fact that, say there's a group of people and everyone has to lose weight, but you're always saying one person has to go on the diet. But it doesn't make sense. You can't do this alone. I'm not dismissing, you know, the effects that the climate has had. Climate change is going on with our country, but we can't do things alone, because we will just devastate our economy, and we won't have an impact on this CO2 emissions, because you're going to have more being done in other ways. So as a percentage, it's not going to make a difference.
We've been talking with Corning Republican Assemblyman Phil Palmesano. Assemblyman Palmesano, thank you so much for calling in live today.
Thank you, Brian.
Always great having you on, and please stay on the line. AM 1480 WLEA Hornell.